Often we think of meditation practice as an opportunity to experience some seclusion from the sense impressions that we are buffeted by in our life, and often in an attempt to seclude ourselves from experience, we can very easily create a sense of inner tension, trying to keep things out. So sitting outside, which is for me, a very special and rare opportunity here in the city, this neighborhood, instead of practicing seclusion, we practice unfurling our mind and making room for everything. Until our mind is so open, empty, balanced, impartial, non-reactive, that anything can be experienced. Anything can be experienced without necessarily losing our sense of embodied, aware presence. So we start, as we do each week, by letting our eyes close softly and locating ourselves in the only place that makes it possible to have experience, which is our physical body with its perceptions and senses. It's within this body, this experience of the body, that we experience directly the world. Not our ideas of the world, but the immediate felt sense of the world as it touches us and as we touch it. So to sit in the middle of this world to be able to accommodate the whole range of experience that floats through our lives, through our consciousness, it's helpful if our mind is settled into our body. So we feel the contact of our rear on the cushion or the chair. We feel all the various points of contact that help us to mingle our mind with our body and have them in the same location. Our lips touching, our eyes, our hands. And finally, we feel the sense of our whole body, a field of sensations, like points of feeling or stars flickering in the sky. We feel them floating in the openness of our awareness. So once you feel a little bit settled in this experience of your sitting body, sitting field of sensations, tune in for a moment to what we might call the space of mind, space of awareness. Let it be wide and open, like the sky. So that might be something you imagine or sense or feel, that your mind is like a clear, empty sky without any limits. And once you're a little bit settled, shift your attention to the different sounds that you hear. The distant sounds, the sound of my voice, life, the whole cacophony of sound. Let all the sounds, loud and soft, arise and pass. Within the sky-like nature of your mind. Sounds come and go. Mind is like space. Sounds arise in that space and they pass away. Make no effort to hear the sounds. Let the sounds arise and let listening happen by itself. Stations like points of feeling or stars flickering in an evening sky. Sounds, sensations. In our direct experience, we don't experience head, shoulders, back, front, arms, or legs, just points of sensation, flickering. In that open space of mind. relaxed, impartial, sky-like nature of the mind. In the clear, open, welcoming space of mind, become aware of thoughts and images, like clouds passing through an empty sky. The thoughts like clouds have no roots. They float freely, empty, free in the open, sky-like nature of the mind. Thoughts and images. Floating freely in this clear, sky-like nature of your own mind. It's clear, open, like vast space. Look within your own mind. Clear, empty, not made of anything. Shining, containing every possible experience, but not limited by it. Rest in this sky-like, welcoming nature of awareness. Rest. In natural peace. welcome all of those who were at Spirit Rock this last week for the five-day Labor Day retreat. And I hope this was not too much of a shock to your system, as we did a similar kind of practice of opening, unfurling our minds, opening that capacity of our minds to be very sky-like, and the sounds were not quite as interesting. I was thinking a lot about the world, you know, both in a lighthearted way and also a serious way during the sitting. In the lighthearted way, I was thinking that this is it. You know, we're right in the middle of it, and all the many, many people, you know, the racing engines and the people doing, you know, having conversations and the whatever is going on in this world, when we hear it directly, we see this is the way the world is. This is how we actually experience it. And I was also thinking in the lighthearted side of it, something I usually reflect on as just being part of my own mind, the words of Bhante Gunaratna, where he says, especially for meditators, somewhere in the process of your meditation, you will come to the realization that you are completely crazy, that your mind is a shrieking madhouse on wheels barreling down a hill, utterly out of control and hopeless. He says, don't worry about this. It's not a problem. It's no worse than it was yesterday. You just didn't notice. And so when I was thinking tonight, I was saying, oh, somewhere in the process of my life, I will realize that this world is a shrieking madhouse on wheels barreling down a hill, utterly out of control. Crazy. But not to worry about this. It's no worse than it was yesterday. Actually, the Dalai Lama says it's better. That there's more awareness than there was. And we know by the total proliferation of mindfulness in every element of people's lives, in every walk of life now, that people are waking up. So you can get very pessimistic if you only rely on the national news, NPR and Fox News, and you know all the different news. You'd think that the sky is falling, and it is to a certain degree, but it's always been falling. There's nothing new under the sun, really, except maybe climate change. And we do have to, we really have to wake up in that regard. It's no joke. And that was in the serious sense. I as I was thinking of the world, I was thinking of my favorite passage from the Advaita Vedanta teacher Sri Nisargadatta, where he says, the world is the way it is because people are the way they are. And as long as people are the way they are, the world will be the way it is. Perhaps if the problems, the human-created problems are accelerating, it's partly because of the way that we are. And if we want a peaceful world, if we want a safe world, there have to be safe and peaceful people. It's not something you can impose on the world. It has to start in each of our hearts and especially each of our actions. And it's certainly a call to be an activist, to do whatever we can do, both in our own individual lives and to help wake up other people about the real dangers that we're in, especially in regard to climate and so many other things. But the real change of heart, the real peaceful world that only arises if there are peaceful people, it starts by each of us in our own way, putting our mind in our body. It's coming here. I mean, coming here into this present moment. And on a talk I gave at the end of a talk I gave on the retreat, I read one of my favorite passages from Derek Walcott, a poem called Love After Love. I thought I would actually start tonight with this poem because I think it speaks to what we all have to do in order to become a more peaceful person and then bring more peace to the world besides all of our, and be a peaceful activist instead of an angry activist. So this is from Derek Walcott, Love After Love. The time will come when with elation you will greet yourself arriving at your own door, in your own mirror, and each will smile at the other's welcome and say, sit here, eat. You will love again the stranger who was yourself. Give wine, give bread, give back your heart to itself, to the stranger who has loved you all your life, whom you ignored for another, who knows you by heart. Take down the love letters from the bookshelf, the photographs, the desperate notes. Peel your own image from the mirror. Sit, feast on your life. So I want to highlight a little bit some aspects of this poem. And I think I'll start with the part about peel your own image from the mirror. Take down the love letters, the desperate notes, the photographs. Peel your own image from the mirror. Sit, feast on your life. So just for example, somebody asked for more examples last week, which was great. When we're sitting here, if you're sitting here quietly and you want quiet, and your whole identity is wrapped around the idea, the image of yourself as somebody who needs quiet. So it's, you hear this whole cacophony of sounds, and you might say to yourself, all those sounds are interrupting my quiet. So it's the same sounds, but it's being filtered through what we call the personality view, the view of myself. It becomes all about me and my quiet. Consequently, when the sounds arise, I become reactive. I become my reaction of not liking then accelerates into an internal narrative about all this noise that's interrupting my silence. And it gets co-opted by the view about myself, the story about myself, and it's no longer just sound. So our meditation practice asks us to notice that, to notice the difference between what's being heard. It's very simple, just wild, amazing. Just hearing, see the difference between that, and see the difference of how we experience it when it gets filtered through the sense of what it means about me. And so we can see when it means something about me, that's the image in the mirror, the desperate notes, the photographs, all the stuff about myself that I'm often filtering my experience through. When I filter it through that, I feel jangled. When I simply hear it as sound, when I come out of the tangle of my personality view and just hear things on present on what's actually happening. Because what our practice is all about truth. It's about what's happening. Now, what's happening may be that whole little personalizing in my mind. But if I'm mindful of that, that just becomes another thing that's being noticed. And then I can see that the sound is just sound. Some loud sounds, some soft sounds, some pleasant sounds, some unpleasant sounds. When it's not filtering through me, where's the suffering? The suffering comes when somehow it gets personalized. It becomes about me. And I begin to experience things from that point of view. Now, just because I've shifted to a point of view where I'm just experiencing the sound as it is, it doesn't mean that I won't have some kind of story about what it means about me. I might experience that story, but I'll notice it. I'm repeating myself a little bit. But it's a different vantage point. The vantage point of simplicity. And it's the vantage point of noticing, of clearly comprehending what it is that's happening. So if I'm noticing the personality story, the photographs, the desperate notes, whatever drama that I'm playing through my mind, in addition to the sound, then that story is equal, absolutely equal, to the sounds that are being heard. I don't need to get rid of it. It's just part of what it means to be human, is I have a personality view. I have a story about myself. I think of myself as the center of the universe, and everything is about me. Is it just me? just seeing if you're on your toes. So I think this may not feel like as meaningful of an example in your life. Now just take the example of having a conflict with your mother. You're in the middle of a big conflict with your mother, a festering conflict, lasted years. And every time you get together with your mother, talk to her on the phone, there's just some kind of ignition, some kind of eruption. Any of you ever have any of that? Or your father, or your partner, or your boss, or whoever it is that you're in conflict with. Your child. You know, I noticed that when I relate to my daughter, Molly, when I relate to her as a human to human and just experience what she's doing, I experience some of it as pleasant, some of it as unpleasant, but sometimes when I experience it through the lens of being her father, the identity view that I'm her father, I'm a little bit more reactive. Then it filters through all my likes and my dislikes, who I think a child should be like. And this is all about it's all about my view. And so often when people have conflicts with other people, if for one moment in the span of their conflict, they could just see that their identity view is operating, the identity of daughter, the identity of mother, whatever it is, and could simply see that as just an appearance, as an idea. Step out of it for a moment. And stepping out of it doesn't mean you don't have it. It means that you recognize it as just a view. And instead, you view from the vantage point, from the wider vantage point of awareness of things just the way they are. It's just the way it is, that conversation. And somehow, when I experience it outside of being bound up in that identity, even with somebody that I have a pretty, pretty entrenched habit with, when I can step out of that identity, often, especially parents and children, you can step out of the vantage point of being a child or being the parent, you get a whole different perspective. It's much easier to have equanimity, and inevitably I'll have less reactivity to whatever it is that's happening. I can more see it the way it is. So much of our practice of meditation is to see the difference, to peel our own images about ourselves from the mirror, take down the love letters, take down the dramas for a moment, just notice them, but see beyond, see from beyond them, and feast on our life that we experience immediately and directly. You know, everybody here, as we, you know, part of what the beauty of practicing in a group is, the intensity of coming together as a group, is that it becomes a little less about me and a little bit more about us together. You know, there, of course, there's plenty of space here, and it's beautiful to consider that you, that I'm here sitting with a group, and you can consider, there's so many things on a personal level that you would want to cultivate, in terms of you want to be here to support other people, you want to be non-harming, you want to offer a feeling of safety to the people around you. So that's a beautiful intention, but in doing that, you melt away the sense of your being so independent and self-existing, so apart from the flow of this group. It actually, those kinds of thoughts about yourself help you enjoin with others, melt away that separateness. And in the silence, the separateness melts away. And maybe for a few moments in the time that we're together, your past ideas of yourself fade away, and before the future ones come, you taste a little bit of your life in that, you could call it bare simplicity. You're simply aware. And you're likely to notice, after your last thought of yourself has passed and before the next one comes, that there's often a very peaceful, open space, inviting, comfortable, easeful. And that's actually, you experience a kind of openness. It's the same person that was mentally ill 10 minutes ago. The exact same person. But for a moment, you've peeled the love letter, you've taken the love letters, the photographs off the bookshelf, you've just dropped the desperate notes, the stories about yourself, the views of yourself as limited. And you've peeled your image from the mirror. That's your image. That's your situation. That's your past. On present evidence, you start to feel, you can feel whole and awake, simple. Somehow this simplicity, this simple presence, free of the image of the mirror, or at least noticing it, This is taken as a special event instead of the real deal. Maybe this is the one real deal that you've had, and the rest is you've been in a trance. You know, people who come on retreats, it's a wonderful thing. They say, when I go back to the real world, but I always say, if you're experiencing life with your senses fresh and open, there's nothing more real than that. What we live like in our daily life is mostly an imaginary world that floats through our mind. That is because the stories of ourself on present evidence is not ourself. The story of even your beautiful story of your life is not you. It's a story about your life, which is wonderful. And it's one of the main ways that we share and exchange information and get to know what it is that formed us, what it is that made us who we are. But a story of yourself is not yourself. A thought of yourself is not yourself. So sitting together, really, and especially in a place that keeps waking us up to the immediacy of things like this, it just naturally kind of it deflates the whole view, the conviction that I have, and that something's wrong with me, something's wrong with life, something's wrong. One of the beautiful things that the Buddha said is whatever you frequently dwell upon becomes the inclination of your mind. If you keep dwelling upon the world as a frickin' mess, how many times do you think that? Every time you do that, you create a harsh and dark and hateful and problematic world. And I'm not saying deny the problems that we have. We have enormous problems. But how you think moment to moment, how you create yourself in the midst of this world determines, it's like it's magic in a way. Our projections manifest. And that's how you see, that's why they say, you know, a pickpocket only sees people's pockets. We want to see the world as much as we can, freshly, unfiltered by so many views about things. And in the middle of it, you become someone who actually brings light and love and non-harming to this world. Because you're not busy creating over and over again the view that the world is a misery. Is it a misery on present evidence? Before you consult your memory. So nothing has changed in the world since we started sitting tonight. Except for a few people that have been just waking up to, yeah, there's, if I think about the world and all its problems and so many things that need to be done, but really, in order for me to really help, I need, the hope is in being full of life, full of goodness, full of good intentions. And then that just overflows. Then I can actually do something. We need this. We need, as my teacher Punjaji used to say, we need the past and thoughts to suffer. We don't need anything to be free. So our freedom is something that we can recover. As Thich Nhat Hanh says, you are the richest person on earth who've been going around begging for a living. Stop being the destitute child. Reclaim your heritage. And then give it to others everywhere you go. Give it away, give it away, give it away, give it away. We all have so much to give. We are just filled with an inexhaustible resource called love, called caring, called intelligence. And if we're shrouding ourselves in a constant repetition of views about the past, views about ourselves, desperate notes, images, photographs of our life, we actually block that joy that is available to us. I'm out. It's a joy to be able to just shout this out loud. Sure. You know, because you know, we as a Dharma teacher, you know, somebody who serves in that role has the good fortune of being able to watch what happens when especially when I lead retreats, and I see it on Tuesday night as well. But when you lead retreats, and this 5-day retreat that I just came out of yesterday, where every day I was, you know, working with people and slowly seeing again and again how just taking the love letters off the bookshelf, the images, the desperate notes, just people peeling all their stories from the present moment, unfurling their minds, opening their minds, clearing their senses, each person is so damn beautiful. Everybody has got that Buddha nature. Everybody's got that awake, heartful presence, the tenderness. And then the collective feeling of people who are so open and heartfelt. It just gives me so much confidence that if we just, what does he say again? Take down the love letters from the bookshelf, the photographs, the desperate notes, peel your own image from the mirror, sit and feast on your life. You will love again the stranger who is yourself. Give wine, give bread, give back your heart to itself, to the stranger who has loved you all your life, whom you ignored for another, who knows you by heart. So what is it in us that knows us by heart? What do we discover when we peel the images about ourselves from the mirror? What can we say about ourselves in real time? Anybody willing to play?
That we have basic senses.
I have basic senses. That's it? That's not problematic, is it? What else in real time do we discover?
We're here.
We're here. We have real openness to joy. How about we're aware?
Breathing.
We're breathing. Little different than the image we're walking around with and thinking about all day about ourselves. That secondhand version of ourselves that plays in our mind doesn't even describe somebody that doesn't actually exist. It's usually all bound up in comparing, measuring, insufficiency, hunger, lack. So we all have that, but we can wake up and notice it as another one of the sense experiences that we have. Oh, that's the story of lack. That's the story of me. Oh, that's a sound. That's a mood. That's love. It's all part of the display of life. But if I operate from that instead of relate to that story, I get very small and I lose that access to joy. You don't need to be somebody to be joyful. Remember that silly little poem, everybody wants to be somebody. Nobody wants to be nobody. But if that somebody could just be nobody, that nobody would really be somebody. Anyway, I'm sorry. I always hesitate. It goes through my mind. Should I say that again? Ralph Waldo Emerson said, "Who you are, shout so loudly, I can't hear what you say." We want to be in touch with that. We want to step at least, we never want to deny the fact that we are a person who's a male or a female, who has been privileged or not, wounded or not, our ethnic, racial, whatever our heritage, we never want to deny that. We want to celebrate our differences, our unique individuality. But we also want to touch that place in us that is beyond all of our differences, all of our names, all of our stories. So that's practice includes both. So any comments before we call it a night?
Can we do this again outside?
If the weather permits. We were talking during the break about finding a way to have amplification so that we could actually do it more often. Can you hear me in the back? No? Oh, you can. Great. Let's see if there's anything else that I wanted to. This seems like a good night to read the words of Jeff Foster again. I thought I had with me. Yes. Just creating a little context for this passage. It's all about opening to, not defending so tightly our small little views of ourselves, but seeing that we have everything within us, that we're not limited to just this little narrative about ourselves and our different views and opinions and our wants, our longings. We're a lot bigger than that. And we spend a lot of time defending our views and being so reactive about how things should be and how we should be and how the world should be. So this is Jeff Foster's answer to this tendency of mine. And this is how I'll close, and then we'll sit for a moment again. This is entitled Humility as Nothing to Defend. I find truth in everything or in anything anyone ever says about me. So nobody can be my enemy. Call me a fraud, I can find it. Call me a liar, I can find it. Call me a failure, I can find it. Call me unreasonable, irresponsible, ignorant, deluded, full of ego, totally unenlightened. The worst being in the world, I can find all of it. As consciousness, I can find anything. Like you, I have nothing to hide, nothing to lose, and no image to protect. Every possible facet of human experience is available here. This is truly the end of war. It is the end of protecting and defending a mirage called me. So next time you get triggered by something someone says to you or about you, ask yourself this: what am I defending? This inquiry is the key to unimaginable peace. Just about.
I'm thinking about situations in which someone truly is destructive to your well-being.
If somebody is truly destructive to your well-being.
Yeah, and so there's actually, it's not good to be. It's not. I'm just wondering what the freedom would be in realizing. Yes, I can become aware they are triggering me, but really, it's not a good idea to accept that.
Now, freedom to become aware that they are triggering you is also the freedom to say, get me out of here. And you know, the more aware presence we have, the more intelligently we would respond to a situation like that. We would remove ourselves from it. So it's just not adopting a view that there's nothing to defend. It's actually living with that kind of openness that allows us to say, no, you can't do that. Or I'm not safe here, and I need to get away. That's an appropriate defense. But to just defending an idea about ourselves, it's just makes us small and tight and very vulnerable, very insecure. If I think I'm great and you're telling me I'm not, how far does my inflation go? It's flimsy. So this, we get very hung up on views. So I, by all means, if when we're in danger, you take care of yourself. That's intelligence. Anyway, let's sit quietly. Thanks for the question. So may we all awaken to our creative potential, to love, to intelligence, compassion. May our boundless qualities, immeasurable qualities flourish. May our flourishing be dedicated every day to the welfare and benefit of everyone, including ourselves. May all beings be touched by wisdom and compassion. May we all learn to do the right thing. Thank you. Anne has an announcement.